This time I will talk about the guidelines on gender equality, which we, meaning Easy Davita and ICS, would like you to take part and to be part and to create the change that we all want to see, and that Miss Minister also spoke about a few minutes ago. So if we take a look a bit at the statistics, I know statistics and numbers can be interpreted in different ways. But anyway, in EU in 2016, the source is women and men on boards in listed companies in the EU 2016. We can see that the EU average is being a women and being on board of the listed companies is at approximately 23.3%, which is quite an increase from 5 years ago. So things that we are doing, that Europe is doing, are having some good impact. But nevertheless, if you can take a look at this bit shadowed line between 40% and 60%, you can see that there is this so-called gender balance zone, meaning that we have to have at least 40% women and men, both sexes, on boards to have gender balance, that we can talk about the gender balance. So we lack something from 23% to 40 at least percent, if in order to be able to talk about the gender balance and gender equality on boards. And we all know if the board is not balanced, if the management is not balanced, the measures and activities within the organization will not be taken, will not be adopted, and the women will have to struggle. I'm sorry to use this word, to climb the ladder, to participate a bit stronger, to participate more. So this is the picture of EU. And the same data for Macedonia said that in Macedonia there is only 16% of women on boards in the larger companies. But let's take a look what we discovered in our research last year, conducted by Easy Davita and Institute of Communication Studies. 30% of women, according to our respondents, we sent it out to 1,000 people, 1,000 organizations, and the response rate was approximately one third, so 304 people answered our survey. And they said that 30% of women are on top management position in the companies, which is encouraging actually. And it means that only 10% still miss to fall into this gender balance zone. So nevertheless, we thought that it would be useful for Macedonian organizations, companies, NGOs, institutes, politicians, etc., to present good cases and good practices in so-called guidelines. So the content of this NASOKI, of these guidelines, consists of different aspects of why gender equality and inclusion is actually important. So if we have to take a look into consideration the social impact, the economic impact, the financial impact, right? So it's not. We don't talk only about women and men, we talk about the society and what is right to do. So just consider 80% of all purchases, right, of all purchases are made by women. So decision makers, what to be bought, are women, but not only in hair and dresses and let's say kitchen supplies, everything, also houses, cars, what you can think of, the women make decision in 80% of all purchases made. So it's important for companies to understand that and to include the right language, right appeal, let's say, to address women across the globe, across or in Macedonia in concrete fail. So financial results are better for companies because women has lower attitude to risk. We are not inclined to take risk. Yeah, we don't like risk. We want everything to be settled or right. So we are moderate risk takers. Then we take into consideration when we look for a solution, we look a huge picture. So we don't look only one corner or one aspect. we have a tendency to have comprehensive solutions, which is also positive, has also positive impact on financial results. Then we really do better understand our customers. And if women make 80% of purchase decisions, then you know we understand women, usually understand women. I know it's simplifying, but nevertheless. Then it was stated in several researches and surveys that women have higher level of creativity and are more inclined to innovate, to find new solutions to problems, or to find new problems and then solutions for them, right? Then it's also impacted the greater return on education and recruitment. So basically what we are talking about is that we have more effective teams, more effective management teams, and usually that implicates that if teams are more effective, then usually companies more has better financial results. But not to stay only with words, we can take a look at the numbers. Financial results show that the difference between companies with and without women in boards or on boards, we talk about Fortune 500 companies, so the best companies there are, they actually produce a 35% higher return on equity and 34% higher stakeholders value, and even 112% higher return on invested capital. So these are numbers that really need and have to persuade our, our stakeholders, our shareholders, our people that gives us capital, that is really good to have balanced boards, to have balanced management teams. And these are the source are the Catalyst and the McKinsey that says that in the McKinsey study from 2007 says that 56% higher incomes, it means half of the all incomes is higher if the management boards are gender balanced. Yeah, but if we take a look and compare the sector itself, we see that the return on equity is 41% higher. The EBITDA is 56% higher, and the growth in share value is 170% higher if we have balanced management and balanced boards by gender. So these are numbers that are quite meaningful, right? I think that you would agree that it's important not only from social aspect and because it's right to have, if we have a higher educated if we have women that are higher educated than men, it's not only right, but it's also effective, it's financially effective, right? So what we are talking in NASO key in guidelines is that the goal is to increase business performance through balanced leadership, through balanced management, because of complementarity of genders, right? We talked about the risk-taking, which is lower with women and it's higher with men. And sometimes it's good to take risk. It's not something wrong, but it has to be, right? It has to be considerate risk, okay? So the goal is to present why it is important. And here is, let's say, here is the model of the supporting activities, consisted of six parts of six topics within a huge topic. One topic is staffing. Right, at least one woman out of three candidates. When you search for new candidates, you usually have to you have the pool, and within the pool there can be a lot of men and fewer women, or vice versa. So we make sure that the shortlist has at least one third of women, let's say. Then career sponsorship, meaning that we take care of women who want to get promoted, who want to build their career. And we find a leader sponsor who helps women, who help women doing that. Then special educational programs for women and special career plans, because it's a fact that women really start career, let's say, between 25 and 30, and then we focus on having our families, right? And at the age of 42, 45, we start to build our career once again. So the career plans are different for men and women. Then performance management. it's important to find key performance indicators that are suitable for women. Yeah, so it differs what kind of things that we measure. Is this also empathy? How many clients do we get? How many clients do we attain, etc. So be careful. Yeah, it's different between men and women. And then, of course, career mentoring, mentorship plans, mentor pairs, etc. And one also very important is to set the target share of women. Yeah, meaning that if we know that this gender balance zone is 40 to 60%, the goal is to set our share of women on boards and middle management level to 40 or 45 or even 50%.